Hi guys, Jonathan Grimm here for Guitar Interactive Magazine. We are at the Keeping the Blues Alive Cruise Mediterranean version part 3 and we're here with the one and only Don Martin. How are you doing this morning?
I'm tired, but I'm great.
Well, I'm not surprised, mate. You know, you give 110% absolutely every show. You were still playing right through to the early hours of the morning with the crowd going wild for
it's
you.
Great fun.
So I'm delighted that you managed to say, well, you got here before we did.
Aye. I was surprised too. It was only my manager came to the door because I got the times wrong.
Yeah.
And he's like, Dom, why are you not dressed? Get out of the room and get down here.
That's it. Well, it's not the most exciting thing for the guys, but the time changes are all over the place. And when you've got to prepare for these shows, that's an added.
It's an added dimension. It is. It's an added dimension completely. But it's a challenge. I kind of like it. You know, I like the challenge of it. If it was easy, everybody would be doing this.
Absolutely. So just taking it right back to begin with. When you hear a player like yourself with so much passion and power on stage, it's got to be one of these ones that's no fluke, you know, that's clearly from a young age being very inspired by that type of performance. When did you first sort of hear something, live that really captured your imagination in that way?
I think it was just my dad putting on LPs. You know, the very first memory I have of music is The Wall, Pink Floyd.
Right.
You know, my dad putting that on that LP, I must have been like 4 or 5, and I just have a jaded memory of it, really. And my first, blues song was Shameless the Dog, which was Pink Floyd again. It's on the Metal album. And I didn't know what it was I knew it was something different than everything else on that album because it had elements of jazz and all sorts of crazy psychedelic stuff. But when Shameless the Dog came on, it was something about it that I just felt the rhythm of it. And I identified with it on some level. And I wanted to hear more. I wanted to hear more of that progression and the dog howling and stuff, and whatever was going on. It just seemed it was something so laid back about it and so cool about it that I could feel it, I could feel it more than I could feel listening to the other music, whatever was happening in the house at the time.
Sure.
And my dad always played guitar. He was a phenomenal guitar player. He really was. The only way I can describe my dad playing was if Ralph McTell and Tommy Emmanuel had a baby,
wow,
my dad would have been that baby. He was that good, he really was. But he died at 46. He drank all his life and, he didn't really do anything with it, but he had the talent. He just didn't know what to do with it, which is sad. But I learned so much from just watching him. And he took me to see Ralph McTell when I was 10 years old, and that's when I realized how good my dad was. Because I'm not saying anything bad about Ralph, because I love Ralph to bits. But I realized that my dad was playing versions of Ralph McTell songs that far surpassed anything that Ralph was doing. And I was like, wow, my dad's an amazing guitar player. I better start listening and learning as much as I can from him. And I did, and I was just his shadow for a while. I did everything he did, so any bad he did was an influence on me as well. So,
That
took me a long time to figure that out.
Obviously, there's a lot of positives come out of that because of the talent that you recognize that. But you do find with some tremendous talent, there can be that combo of.
It's like a darkness to it.
Just going through it yourself and coming out the other side, where do you think that stems from? This combo of, such a strong self-expression, talent, but yet this way of almost numbing it at some points,
I really don't know. I've no way of explaining it at all to people. It's just, I've just kind of taking everything for what it is, and I take it at face value, and try to make sense of what I can from it, but the main thing is the music comes first.
Of course,
I've sacrificed everything to do this. Everything, all relationships and family life, and everything has been sacrificed for me to continue doing this music thing, which is the only way I can. I mean, it's not a want. It's a need, and I need to do it. If I don't do it, I don't feel right. I don't walk properly. I don't talk properly.
So it's almost like a therapy. It's like this, how you're communicating.
Definitely a therapy. And I'm not playing. I don't mean it in a bad way or in a negative way at all. I mean, the crowd's there and they paid money to come. If they've paid money to come and see you play, you gotta be good. But I'm not. I've never played for them. I maybe used to in the past, but now I'm playing for me. Which is a really good kind of way to think about it.
Once absolutely, and
the pressure just leaves you then.
And absolutely, so ironic that, it's that record, The Wall, when you think about the live situation around that and what inspired the writing of that. You know,
it's you listen to that album and then you kind of listen to it for the rest of your life and you keep finding out what it's about and where it came from and who wrote it, and like Roger Waters and everything, Dave Gilmour playing guitar on that. It's like Comfortably Numb, that solo and everything.
Yeah, it keeps relating to you in more ways.
Sound, yeah,
absolutely. This album's particularly special for you in terms of how complete it is. Definitely. Could you just talk a little bit on that, about why it's such an important record?
Well, the very first album I made, I was still drinking, you know. I don't really remember a lot of it, but I didn't really have a lot of control about how it was produced and mixed and whatever, you know. But I didn't really know what I was doing either, so I kind of was like, yeah, you do that, you know, make it sound, you know, like it does in the room, please. But it didn't really work out, you know. But it's still, I'm not dissing the album at all, and for people who liked it, I'm really grateful for them, really, really grateful. It's not necessarily what I wanted, but it's still a good album, you know. It's a very personal album, Spain to Italy. I didn't ever want anyone to hear those songs. I never wrote any songs for anybody to listen to them. It was never intentional, like writing songs with the intent for people to listen to them. I wrote these songs because I was going through something. This is the only outlet and therapy I have, you know, like you were saying about the therapy thing earlier. I wrote them because I needed to get stuff out of myself, and this is the only way I can do it. But when I wrote Spain to Italy and I was making that album, I didn't realize that I had to take it on tour and play them every night. So every time, like 18-day tour, you know, I had to play the songs every day, and I was like transported back to that room every night, and I just wanted to die.
Oh, jeez.
You know, I could not handle it. So after that, I realized that I should maybe write less personal songs and write some songs that I would actually like to play live. You know, that was a bit of an evolution for me. So Savage Life is a little bit less personal, but there's still personal songs, like Echoes is very personal, you know, and stuff like that. But there's some good rock songs on there, like 12 Gauge and Unsatisfied, which are, you know, good rocking songs to play live. And I was surprised to myself, because I've only really played electric guitar for 5 years or so. It's still a new thing to me. I don't really know what I'm doing. And it was surprising that I could actually write a rock song and something that had some lead licks in it and stuff like that that I could work on. I was really proud of myself for that. This album, this new one, is 100% me, you know. Like, nobody messed with it. I didn't let anybody put in things that were like weird, or like the whole thing was meticulously recorded. And we had 9 days in the studio in Port Leas, which is in Ireland, the Golden Egg Studios, and we worked with Chris and Graham, who fixed the Savage Life album. We were working in a studio in Belfast for that album, and we realized that we'd made a huge mistake in the studio that we chose, because the guy just didn't have a clue what he was doing. He had great equipment and everything, but he was, you know, I don't want to say anything bad. I could say a lot of things that are bad, but I choose to be positive. He just didn't have a clue, the poor guy. So we gave what we had. We had no money to go back and start again, so we gave what we had to a place called the Production Suite in Dublin, which is Chris and Graham. And they fixed it all. They fixed everything, and they made it sound good. They put it in phase, all these issues they had. It was an absolute train wreck. So I wanted to bin the album. I wanted to start like on some other project or just forget it all together and just, you know, go back to doing tours and whatever. But we might as well just finish it, just get it done, just get something out there. It doesn't matter if it sounds like crap and whatever, you know.
We'll just fire it out
and we'll see what happens. They did a tremendous job at fixing that album. I'm indebted to them. So I used them again to do this new one, Buried in the Hill. And they were a joy to work with. You know, they really know their stuff. But they were aware that I was going to stick to my guns on this one, you know, and I wasn't going to let anybody mess with it or do stuff that I didn't want. I was very selfish with it, but it does say Don Martin on the album. It doesn't say Don Martin and, you know, and if it did, then it would be a different story. So I had to be completely selfish about it. For better or for worse, it is what it is. I can listen to that whole album from start to finish without feeling any hints of frustration or anger or embarrassment. And that, to me, is the most important thing when making an album.
Yeah, absolutely.
That I can actually, because I made it for me. I didn't really, like I was saying, I didn't make it for anybody to listen to. I'm very grateful for anybody who does listen to it and takes an interest in it, you know, but that, the intention wasn't there, you know, for that.
I mean, I've really got to congratulate on it, because, I mean, to be able to achieve that, you know, still so early on in your career and have that feeling, you know, it's almost like you're really becoming you know, I mean, you're always going to evolve. Great artists, you know, will continue to, and you know, can see that happening with you. But in a lot of ways, four records in, it's as if this is you really arrived.
Yeah.
Now.
Yeah. It took me a couple of albums, but I got there in the end. You know, now, it's something that I'm happy with.
Just to touch on those you know, extremely personal tracks of the first record.
Yeah.
Now, performing these, you know, do they have a different, you know, do they have a new lease of life? Do they come, or is it still?
I don't play them. Okay. I don't play them at all. Mm. You know, Savage Life's done for me here, and
do you not think you'll ever return to it?
Spain to Italy. I don't think I ever will. No, because I wrote those songs like Spain to Italy's about my dad mostly. You know, and just had a horrible time watching him die. You know, over a period of 4 years. I was his carer, and he was like my best mate. You know, we did a lot of stuff together. Like he wasn't really. I mean, he was a bad influence on me in terms of drugs and drink. You know, and when he died, I just became a magnet for psychopaths. Like I just, everywhere I went, it was just mayhem. It's just a spiral of drugs and alcohol, and I wanted to die, and I nearly did a couple of times. I welcomed it. You know, I was surprised that I got out of a couple of situations that I got myself in, and I was very, very surprised to still be alive. And no, I don't think I'll ever go back to those. You know, I think I'll just keep moving forwards.
Well, you know, and it's fantastic that we're here in this environment, and you're performing, you know, better than ever. Last night was one of those great shows, and you know, to see you live is really, you know, a force of nature. I mean, you know, you're fantastic with the dynamics. The whole band are great, of course, and there's
a lot of tremendous communication
between you all.
Yeah.
It's a pleasure to watch.
Thanks, man.
But just to touch specifically on the dynamics, because you have some incredible moments of power and aggression, and you know, as a guitar player, that can be, well, a vocalist as well, that can be really tricky, because you can blow out your voice, you can add a little bit too much tension on you know, a note, and then all of a sudden the next three notes you're not going to be able to play anymore. You know, what's do you think, I mean, I'm sure a lot of it's just a reflex, you know, instinct at this point, but how do you manage tension on stage?
I've never really thought about it, to be honest. You know, the main thing for me and for people who do want to come and see the shows is it's from the heart. You know, there's no bravado or ego, or, you know, there's no BS. Like it's just a genuine, like, heartfelt emotion. You know, and as long as I can get that across to people, it's not a fake show. Like, what you see on stage is what you get off the stage too. Like, there's no middle ground there. You know, I used to try so hard to be somebody else, you know. I used to try all my life to be someone else, and I just gave up doing that. I just couldn't do it anymore, you know. It was like, listen, I'm who I am. My flaws are what they are, you know, and I'm just human at the end of the day, like everybody else. You know, I hid away from people for so long, was so antisocial, but when I realized, like, I'm meeting so many people now that we're all flawed, we're all just the same person, really. We all have these stories. We've all been through all this stuff, like, you know, so I get that people can identify with the songs, and I'm really grateful for that, you know, I really am. But as long as they know that it wasn't written for them to listen to, there was never the intent for that, you know.
I'm
incredibly grateful that they do.
I just, you know, every now and then when you see a great performer, you know, there seems to be that common through line of seeing them in this flow state, you know, and it happens to you, it's certainly during your guitar solos, where you can see you just ride that wave, and then everything, you know, even if it's something that would potentially be, you know, on paper, that might be a note that's slightly sharp or flat, but it works.
It does.
In the same way that Hendrix, the same way Rory Gallagher, you know.
None of it's scripted.
You know,
I have no idea where it's going to go next. I really don't. I mean, you can practice the songs at home, but as soon as you get them on the stage, it's all different. Like, and I keep saying that to the band. I'm with, you know, Ben Graham and Aaron McLaughlin. Like, lads, you know, we can practice it here in the garage all day long, like, but as soon as we get there on the stage, it might change and evolve, and we might do it, always different, you know.
Of course.
As long as the structure's there, the tempo's right, you know, little things like that make a difference, I think, you know.
You've got a combo, you know, on the cruise here, you know, of some, you know, slightly more laid back acoustic, the resonator, you know, versions, and then you get the full band situation with the electric, you know. Can you just talk us through, like, some of the, you know, what your rig setup is for the shows?
I mean, I'll use whatever I can get, you know what I mean. I was I'm not really a gearhead or anything. I was so naive when I started doing, I only started doing a banjo because the Tuesday Night Music Club in England, Richard Dunning's club, I was doing my very first solo tour, which was the Spain to Italy one, but they wanted a band and I didn't have a band, you know, so we hired in two guys. One of them was Rory's ex-drummer, which was a nice experience for me. The other guy played with Deborah Bonham. I think they both played with Deborah Bonham, which is John Bonham's
course.
You know, so it was like there was pedigree there already. I was already nervous going in, and I met the guys like 15 minutes before the gig, so there was no rehearsal or anything. We just hit the road, man, and just did this gig, and it was great. But I was so naive with what I had. I had a cheap Indonesian bullet strat, which was a real nightmare to keep in tune. It was just horrible. And I had a Vox AD30 VT modeling amp, which was okay at all things, but not great at one thing, you know. It was just an awful thing to use. But I was like, oh, this is great. Everything sounds great to me, you know, until I started, like, you know, seeing other players and going, oh, what the hell is he using? Like, what is all this stuff? I think I need to get some more gear, you know. But money is always a problem when it comes to stuff like that. And gear is so expensive, you know. You're trying to acquire a tone, but I think as long as the emotions and the songs come from the heart and it's genuine, I think it'll come. And it did that night, even though the gear was rubbish, and you know, we had 15 minutes to go through the set before the show started. Like, it was a great experience.
Sometimes these limitations, though, they can add up, you know, because definitely, especially even from the, you know, the writing perspective, sometimes, you know, when I'm talking with great artists like yourself, you know, if they're thinking about some greats of the past that have influenced them, they were coming up at a time where you could maybe only get a handful of records, you know, and that was your ingredients for the soup.
That was it.
These days you can pull all the free ingredients from everywhere. And it can mud things up, because definitely, tomorrow you want to be a jazz player, and exactly, you know, and
you have to just follow your heart, you know. Follow your heart, man, and that's it.
What do you think is the key to, you know, having an individual voice on the instrument?
Again, just be yourself, you know. Don't try and be your heroes or try and copy what they do, you know, and try and sound like, oh, he uses that pedal, so I better get one of those and another one as a backup, and oh, he uses that gauge string, so I have to use that gauge string. Like Stevie Ray Vaughan used 13s, apparently. I know he only used a high E13, the rest of it was custom, so it wasn't a full 13 set. People are like, oh, how did he do that? You know, it's like it's some mystical thing. It's never really how you think it is, you know.
It's also incredible with the SRV thing that, you know, so many people, they talk about, like, oh, I need a heavier gauge strings, but when you look at a lot of the greats, there's very few that have, like, I can't think of another player who played 13s.
No, I can't think of anybody, you know, I really can't.
You know, but...
it's crazy.
But, new records out September. You're going to be touring again, as you do your fantastic live shows. Can you just talk, when are you going to be hitting the road in the UK?
Well, next month we'll be in the UK. We'll be there for a month, and then in September we'll be in Europe for a month. You know, so I think we've got December off, which will be nice. I know there's a couple of gigs in December, but I think they're home gigs, so I can actually get back to my house and go to sleep, you know, which is always nice. Like,
And do you get a chance to write when you're on the road? Like,
it's a constant thing, you know. When I was writing the Buried in the Heel album, I was on tour in England and I got sick, you know. I tried to keep going and do the shows, but it was awful, and I felt really bad for the people who had come to see the show. I was like, you know what, just get your money back on the way out, because this isn't working. I tried my best to keep that going. So we were able to postpone a couple of shows to later in the year, and we were able to cancel a couple of others, which was okay, you know. And I have a friend who lives in England called Dave Frohawk, and he lets us stay at his place when we're on tour. Saves us a tremendous amount of money on hotels. The guy's an absolute legend. So we went to his place. I've got a little room there, you know. So the van's there with all the equipment, the amps, the guitars, all the stuff you need. So I got it all out, and I set it all up in that room, and I had 513 voice memos on my phone of all just me, like, going, you know, just on the bus or whatever with my guitar, and just trying to, like, come up with songs, little ideas. About 10% of that was me messing up, like, voice recordings for radio. Hi, this is Don Martin, and you're listening to me. Oh, for God's sake, I messed it up again. You know, that kind of... So it's funny to hear some of those. But I was able to narrow down 11 tracks from them 513. And I wrote that whole album in 2 days. you know, I just sat in that room as sick as I was, and I just
used that moment to
So I was there for those 2 days, and then I just put a pin in it and finished off that tour, you know, and then went back home and started structuring the songs.
And we're delighted that you did. In the show last night, you know, you brought up Chris Buck from Cardinal Black, and
I wanted the best guitar player to come up and play with me. I met him on the stairwell, and I was like a kid, you know. I was like, hey, Chris, you know. He's like, hey, Dom. And I was like, I was so surprised that he knew who I was and knew my name. I was like, oh, I was like taken back a little bit. I thought he was going to be like, what, you know, what do you want? But Chris is such a gentleman, you know. He's such a lovely guy, and he's a phenomenal player, and I've got no fear from him whatsoever, you know, as a player. Like, I want to learn from him, and I think a lot of people find that maybe that'd be a difficult thing to get somebody of that stature up. I mean, I'd get Joe up if Joe wanted to do something. I'd have him up in a heartbeat, you know, because he's such a phenomenal player, and he could school me on some stuff maybe. You know, I toured with Eric Gales, and I wanted to do some stuff with him, and it never really happened. I feel like, you know, I feel like I should have learned so much from Eric, and I learned absolutely nothing from him. I didn't. I always feel like I wasted an opportunity with him, you know. So I'm trying to. I learned from that. And
was that from not approaching him?
He just seemed unapproachable to me.
Oh,
you know?
I see.
He just
seemed
a bit unapproachable, and I guess we were both that busy with that tour anyway. There was so much.
Everyone's
going
got a different process, haven't they? You know, to get ready.
So, yeah, you know, I just kind of left him alone and, you know, let him do his thing. We're all going through stuff too. He's going through some stuff too. He's got demons and stuff like that. So you don't want to kick the hornet's nest and have to bring up some weird stuff with him, you know. But I always feel I missed an opportunity with Eric. So now I'm kind of grabbing on to as many opportunities as I can. I fully expected Chris to say he was busy or he was doing something else, but he jumped at the opportunity to do it. And I was like, I'm so glad that he's willing to, you know, put some time aside for this and really do this with me. So, Chris is one of the best guitar players on there. Everybody on this boat can play guitar. And they can play drums and they can play bass. They're all very, very good. Chris has something that I can't quite explain what it is, I'm not sure. And he helped me tremendously when I got my first pedals and stuff, and I just watched his YouTube videos on how to like set them up correctly and what order works best, but tried things that sometimes this actually does work good, you know, putting them in a weird order. But I owe him a little bit, I think. I owe Chris a little bit for that inspiration. And just to share a stage with him was a great experience for me.
It was quite a moment. I mean, there's been some great moments on here of that type of thing where you've got this, I mentioned it a couple of times in some of the interviews, this almost kind of like brotherhood, you know, in the scene. And it, you know, and it's lovely to watch, because people are dropping their egos and they're you know, just having these great moments performing together. I mean, I spotted Chris. I mean, we know that Chris is a big fan of yours anyway. Chris is, you know, a good friend of the magazine, but we could see him at the side of the stage singing along to your tracks before it came
on. Is that right?
Before it came on, you know?
It warms my heart
so,
wee bit.
So it was
slightly terrified.
Yeah, so it was like, you know, to see that and then coming on, and it's like, oh man, you know, this is a real moment. So I think the only thing that's sad is that it wasn't captured, but you know, hey, we'll never rule out in the future maybe some tour together or something.
I hope so. I really do. I want his band, you know, the band Cardinal Black. I really want them to win, and I think they are going to win. I really do. I've got high hopes for them to really carve out a little future for their music, because they deserve that, you know. They work hard, and that goes for everybody else too, you know. There's room for everyone. We should all be helping each other a bit more. Like, there was, I'm not saying who it was, but the guy walked past me yesterday in the artist room, and I was like, hey man, thanks for the music. And he was like, ah. And I was like, ah, okay. You know, it kind of took me a lot of effort to say that to you, man. You know, a simple thank you would have been enough.
Our accents can be tough though for people.
He has the same accent as us. Don't worry too much about it, man.
So we can narrow it down maybe who it was then. All right, well, look, Dom, absolute pleasure. It's a pleasure to talk with you. Always a pleasure to see you live. We'll look forward to seeing you when you hit the UK again soon.
You're a good guy.
And enjoy
really
the rest of the cruise.
Thank you for your time, man.
Thank you.
Fair play.